ATCM. Today I will be presenting a case on rat hole poisoning. Can we start, sir?
Yes.
A 18-year-old female was rolled into her ER with complaints of alleged history of ingestion of rat hole granules. On initial 10-second assessment, patient was conscious, oriented and obeying to my commands. On primary survey, her airway is patent. There is no pooling
of
sputum.
Any poisoning smell is very important. Sir. You have to document it, whatever may be the poison. So, if a smell you are not documented, there is a chance of missing all these things. Like OP poison and all.
Airway is patent. There is no pooling of secretions or gurgling or hoarseness of voice. Breathing, her respiratory rate is 16 per minute with a saturation of 99%. Air entry was bilaterally equal and chest exertions were normal, sir. She was placed, was rolled in with a rails tube.
Okay.
Circulation part, her blood pressure was 170 with a pulse.
Can you tell the role of aspiration, GI aspiration in poisoning?
Already GI decontamination is usually indicated if the patient presents with the first 1 hour, sir.
Okay.
Maximum to 4 hours, 1 to 4 hours,
if
sir.
If there is a delayed absorption you are suspecting, then up to 4 hours is okay.
Start.
But normally 1 hour is enough. Or after 1 hour, even if you aspirate, there is no use and it may produce harmful effects for the patient.
Then activated charcoal also.
Is it used with rails tube or
actually, we should use with red rubber catheter, sir. 32 to 40 French.
The ideal thing, but now we are not using it.
It is very irritable.
Okay.
Red rubber catheter is not the ideal thing. Red rubber catheter is an ancient methodology that should not be practiced because it's a very traumatic revision. There are specifically designed tubes available for GI decontamination. You have to use it. Red rubber catheter is what we classically see in the old fashioned emergency room, which is not at all should be practiced. That is not the correct way.
Then it is contraindicated in case of if the patient is not able to maintain his airway or patient is drowsy, we usually doesn't prefer a gastric lavage, sir. Usually after securing airway only we'll be preferring that. Then in case of any caustic ingestions, alkaline or acid ingestions, then it is contraindicated.
Okay.
Let me clarify one question. You said rat hole granules. Okay. So basically rat hole is the commonly available brand.
Yes, sir.
But usually it comes as a paste.
Paste.
So when you say it is rat hole granules, either it is not rat hole or it is not granules. Granules is something like aluminium phosphate. And usually rat hole is zinc phosphate. So that will be the
difference. Rat poison you can tell.
Yeah.
Both in availability there is a difference.
Rodenticide
or rat poison, both.
All peripheral pulses were felt equally and bilaterally. Her Glasgow coma scale was E4, V5, M6 with pupils 2.5 millimeter reactive and GRBS was.
What is the importance of pupil in poisoning cases?
Sir, in case of opioid poisonings and all, there will be meiosis, pinpoint pupils will be there, sir. Then in case of OP poisons also, pinpoint pupils will be there, opioids also.
Atropine derivatives, you get dilated
pupils after atropinization.
Not only atropinization, atropine derivatives are there many. Okay, they also have dilated pupils. Okay.
Alcohol?
Yes, sir, dilated pupils. Her temperature was checked, that was 98 degree Fahrenheit. There was no smells.
Temperature also important in poisoning.
Yes,
conditions,
sir.
Like tropin-like poison,
yes,
temperature will be high.
High.
Okay. Some drug-induced hyperthermia can occur. Okay.
She was exposed to check for any other incision wounds or any other dermal lesions. Because in some yellow phosphorus and all, because of the contact with the poison, there can be some dermal
lesions.
Not
only that, many patients present with two types of suicidal attempts. One, they'll take a poison and they cut the arteries. Both are possible. With the other things, like you told, that is also possible.
So as a part of adjuvants, at present this patient is maintaining airway. At present there is no indication for, I asked, since patient's conscious, I asked her when she took that. She told that she took almost 12 hours back. Okay. So at present there is no need of any gastric lavage or activated charcoal. Since she told she took some rodenticide, we can take a baseline VBG or a point of care PTINR just to monitor the progression.
Okay. So you have to always think co-injections. Patient has told that is rat poison, but there is a high chance patient can mix it with many different types of tablets.
Yes, sir.
So that's also possible.
So blood and urine samples were collected for toxicological analysis, rodenticides, pesticides, paracetamol levels were taken, sir. Then sample history, she is not having any comorbidities, she is not taking any regular medicines, no allergies. Her LMP was on January 1st, that means 2 weeks back, sir. She took 10 pellets of rodenticide 12 hours back, associated with water, and following that the patient, after she had some dispute with her family, after that she was found very drowsy and she was taken to...
She's married?
No sir, she's not married.
Okay.
18 year old.
Okay, so when you take LMP, you have to take a consent.
She was taken to local hospital she reached the local hospital within 3 hours. There they inserted a Ryle's tube and gastric decontamination was done. Activated charcoal was not given, just fluids.
For medical legal purposes, what all things you have to preserve in this patient?
If the patient is coming with an exposure, there can be skin exposures also, so we should preserve
this
their clothing.
This patient has come from a different hospital, that is the first thing.
Okay.
So what is the first thing we will try to preserve?
Documents from the other
hospital. Documents from the other hospital is very important, because most of the time we misplace that. Mm-hmm. Okay. The reference letter which is given from the referring center is very, very important. What all things they have observed, what all things they have done, everything should be documented properly. So that is the first thing. Then
If they have not changed the clothes and all, we should preserve the patient's clothes.
Okay.
Then if they have brought the gastric
containment,
or if they have brought some packets or whatever the patient has taken, that should be preserved.
So whatever they have taken to our hospital should be preserved. Okay. In case of a death, we have to hand over all these things to police.
This was the history, sir. There was no history of any cut injuries or associated co-injections. There was no history of vomiting, diarrhea, abdomen pain, perioral lesions or dermal lesions, sir.
Okay, why you are checking perioral lesions and all in this patient?
Some of the rodenticides like yellow phosphorus is an irritant. They can cause oral and mucosal lesions and dermal lesions also. Mm-hmm. And if suppose the patient vomits and all, there can be luminous contents in that when we check in the dark.
Suppose this patient comes directly to you. Okay, so what are the management plans initially? Within 1 hour, the patient had reached.
Depending on the type of phosphorus, we have to distinguish. So we might not be sure, sir. So whenever we are approaching a patient, we should wear our personal protective equipment and then approach the patient, sir. First, we should decontaminate the patient with running water, decontaminate the skin, remove the clothing and preserve the clothing in a separate bag. Then after that, if the patient presents with the first 1 hour, we can do gastric decontamination and activated charcoal can be done. Before that, we should take gastric aspirate sample.
How do you give activated charcoal?
Activated charcoal, we should give 1 mg per kg, that 50 mg.
1 gram per kg.
Maximum
50 gram.
Okay.
50 gram diluted in 250 ml of water should be given through Ryle's tube. It is irritant, so a patient will not be able to swallow.
Okay.
What are the other agents that you can consider when, for example, you are suspecting in terms of yellow phosphorus?
Yes, sir.
Any specific agents that has been told in the textbooks which can be tried?
Yes, sir. This yellow phosphorus is an irritant, so we can give associated with other than activated charcoal, we can give potassium permanganate 1:5000 dilution or copper sulfate. Copper sulfate can bind to the phosphate and form copper phosphate.
Oh.
Then coconut oil can also be given.
These are all theoretically supposed to, you can give when you have suspicion, and you should avoid?
Avoid giving milk and phosphorus, because that can absorb this thing. Yeah.
So that is the one thing in specific to the GAD contamination. Fine. Okay.
This patient was present. So after the sample history, I went to the examination. Her vitals were checked, which was within normal limits, sir. From head to foot examination, there was no dermal lesions or skin lesions. So systemic examination was done, and systemic examination was also normal. There was no abdominal cramps. There was no features of any aspiration, and sensorium was also preserved, sir.
Okay.
So she was admitted into our ICU. So since there is a history of ratiol ingestion, she can go into further stages of poisoning, sir.
When are you expecting the further stages?
In sir, initially patient will be having only nausea, vomiting, okay, mild abdomen pain and all. After that will be in the first day. By the second day, patient can be fully asymptomatic, or some patients will gradually progress. It is according to the dose. If the patient is taking more than 1 mg per kg, patient can suddenly go into stage 3, sir. Stage 3 means patient will go to hepatotoxicity. There are two types of rat poisons. Either it can be super warfarin, or it can be phosphorus, zinc phosphorus, or aluminium phosphorus. So if it
aluminium
is
phosphate.
Aluminium phosphate. So if the patient is taking super warfarin, the patient will go into bleeding manifestations. Prolongation of the PTI NR will be there.
What is this? Why they are called as super warfarin?
Because it is a second generation Coumarin derivative. Okay. What is the
difference from a warfarin to super warfarin?
More action
may not be correct, because it is long acting actually. Okay. It may act for nearly 1 week, comparing to warfarin. Warfarin also acts for 1 week. By 1 week, the potency will slowly come down. But this will last for nearly 1 to 2 weeks. That is a problem. Okay, that's why they are called as potency is there, but duration of action is also more.
Then in this yellow phosphorus, if the patient is taking that, patient will go for hepatotoxicity. Features of hepatotoxicity like hepatomegaly, tender hepatomegaly, hepatic encephalopathy, stupor, coma can be there, and renal failure, acute kidney injury, hematuria can be there, and patient can go into recurrent hypoglycemic episodes. Okay. And hemolysis can be, and electrolyte abnormalities can be there. Hypocalcemia, hypomagnesemia, and hypokalemia can also be there.
Okay. All these things, when you are expecting in this case?
In the stage 3, sir. That means after 3 to 5 days. Sir.
Okay. So after 72 hours, slowly PTNR starts servating. Yes. So that time you expect all these complications. Okay.
Most important thing, when you brief the family, they will feel that the patient is improving, the symptom has improved. They usually third day, fourth day only, the patient will start deteriorating. That you have to clearly explain the family what is going to happen. So they will feel that first day there was some vomiting, second day the patient is fully normal, she is taking normally her feeds, everything. But only after that fourth day only the deterioration will start. So that is very important. They should understand this. Yes. And they should be clearly made available that there is no specific antidote available. So the people will feel that you can give, why are you not giving antidote to this patient? There is no specific antidote available, and all the prognostication has to be done the initial day itself. And to the patient also, they definitely will not say that to the patient that they are going to deteriorate, but to the family, make sure that you are documenting these things. Because they will say that the patient had come here, they were apparently normal, and they didn't do any treatment, and they have started deteriorating after the fourth day. So that is the thing with this zinc phosphate, aluminum phosphate.
So in the initial, when the patient presents with in the initial stage itself, we will be starting on maintenance fluids, sir, and dextrose solution can be started, and we can give N-acetylcysteine. N-acetylcysteine, there is actually no proven benefits for that, but some studies say that we can give as if we are giving for a paracetamol poisoning.
N-acetylcysteine is not recommended in many guidelines, but we can use it like paracetamol poisoning, or even now it is recommended in acute liver injury due to various causes. Here also we can try. Some patients, they show improvement. Definite indication is not there. These are off-label indications. Okay.
Then a glucose monitoring should be checked every 6
hours. What is the dose you give N-acetylcysteine?
In paracetamol poisoning, we will be giving 150 mg. In the first 21-hour protocol, we will be given 150 mg per kg in 200 ml D5 water over 15 minutes.
Okay.
And then followed by 500 mg per kg in 500 ml NS over 4 hours.
Okay.
Then 1000 mg per kg in...
What was given for this patient?
This patient, we just give bronchic infusion 600 mg per kg, per hour, sir.
Okay, per hour infusion.
Again, PCM overdose, there is definitely a role for N-acetylcysteine.
And they have a guidelines.
Clear-cut guidelines. So, we need not use that dose for an other ACLF and maybe for other toxicity. We can go with maybe 300 to 600 mg per hour infusion, maybe to the first 48 hours, that will be the maximum.
Followed by maintenance infusion will be fine for
That will be the correct little bit, because there is no evidence as such.
Mm.
But only thing is that some treatment, something to offer to the patient is only N-acetylcysteine. So it can prevent some toxicity. That is only thing.
Then we should monitor for the bleeding parameters, sir. PTINR should be monitored every 3 to 4 hourly, and LFTs, worsening of the SGOT and SGPT also should be monitored.
Okay. The problem of SGOT, SGPT is initially it will be elevating very high. Once the liver failure, that means liver necrosis occurs, it may not increase at all. So you may think that it is it's not increasing, patient is improving. So that's a very bad sign. Suddenly if LFT is becoming normal means or coming down is very bad thing. Okay.
Factor, which factor is affecting?
2, 7, 9, 10 will be affected.
Okay. Any specific zinc phosphorus and any von Willebrand factor, any correlation is there?
Factor 8 and von Willebrand is there, because factor 8 is bonded to von Willebrand.
Mm.
Also von Willebrand is required for platelet adhesion also.
If the von Willebrand factor level is very low, that means it indicates a bad prognosis, sir.
Okay. So, PTNR elevation is a good indicator for liver injury. When will you get alerted in terms of PTNR values?
PTNR values, we should monitor, and if it is elevating more than 1.5,
okay,
we should get alerted, sir.
Okay. 1.5 is a very important target. If it is more than that, should be very careful. Okay. So
then
what do you do when it increases 1.5 to what you are going to do?
Yes, sir. So in this condition, we can plan for to prevent the liver transplant, which is the which is the last treatment. We can plan for a cytosorb or plasma exchange if at all the patient's INR is worsening.
Extracorporeal correction of toxins.
Toxins. These are indicated mainly for yellow phosphorus poisoning.
Okay.
And the patient should not meet the King's College criteria. Before meeting the King's College criteria, if we are doing ECMO or cytosorb, that will be better, sir.
Okay.
Thing is that you should have a clear-cut idea where the patient should be in a center where there is a facility for liver
transplant.
That should be the first thing. So such patient comes in a peripheral setup, they should be referring this patient to a center where a liver transplant can be offered.
Okay.
Then meanwhile you have some time for liver transplant, either you don't get the donor correctly, so the patient is deteriorating. At that point of time you can definitely think in terms of the cytosorb therapy as a bridging between your initial management and to the liver transplant. And liver transplant will be the final answer to this, because many of the people cannot afford a transplant, or maybe you won't get a correct donor at the correct time. So during that time, the reasonably good outcome with especially with yellow phosphorus has been shown. There are some Indian articles that has come up showing a reasonable outcome. So our experience also is for zinc phosphate, we have few patients who had recovered with plasma therapy exchange and cytosorb therapy. So definitely it can be tried. Cytosorb therapy is definitely superior over just routine plasmapheresis.
We'll have two types of patients. One patient is ready for liver transplant, he meets all the criteria of liver transplant. Other patient, either they are not ready for the liver transplant or they are not meeting the criteria of liver transplant. How do you manage that other type of patients? That is a common thing, because in India you cannot transplant every patient. We'll have to medically treat most of the patients. How do you medically treat this patient?
medically treatment, sir.
Anesthesia, you told. Okay, what else we can?
Patient can go in for coagulopathy. We can manage the coagulopathy.
How do you manage?
If the INR is more than worsening, initially we can try oral or injection vitamin K.
How do you give vitamin K?
Vitamin K oral injections, oral tablets are 1 to 2.5 mg to 5 mg and 10 mg tablets are available.
IV?
IV, 1 ampule contains 100 mg, sir.
Okay. 100 or 10?
Sorry, 10 mg.
So 10 mg IV can be given, 3 days you can give. That will correct most of the vitamin K dependent coagulation factors. That is one way of treating the patient. Other one is fresh frozen plasma. Okay, only problem is this can mask the deterioration. So when you are giving FFP and vitamin K, PTINR may not elevate. That will become normal, but liver will get damaged. So if you are not planning for liver transplant, then this will be a good option. If you are planning for liver transplant, you allow the PTNR to elevate and see what is happening to the PTNR. Only when you are transplanting, then only you meeting the criteria, decide for transplant, then you can treat the coagulopathy. Otherwise, it will be you will get a false information. That is the only issue. Okay. But some patients will go to hepatic encephalopathy. That also we should treat. If you are not planning for liver transplant, how do you manage that?
Hepatic encephalopathy should be managed. Ammonia can rise, sir. So bowel regimen should be started. Okay. Altered sensorium can be there because of the raised ICP. Hypertonic saline can be given, sir.
Correction is first one. Bowel decontamination. What's the name for that? Bowel sterilization. Gut sterilization. You have to do. How do you do it?
Gut sterilization, actually we can do with rifaximin and neomycin. Neomycin is usually not preferred.
Not available. Rifaximin is
rifaximin can be given, sir. Then bowel regimen. Patients should pass at least 3 stools per day.
Okay.
So lactulose retention enema or syrups can be given, sir.
Okay.
Depending on the patient's sensorium.
Okay.
For the neurological part, there can be hepatic encephalopathy. But some studies are telling that to prevent the raised ICP, hypertonic saline can be given.
Okay.
Patient can go in for seizures and all. In such cases, benzodiazepines are also involved.
Benzodiazepines are not very good drug because that prolongs the sedation in CLD. Okay, that is the only issue. Mm-hmm. So many patients who are coming under this King's College criteria, even without transplant, they have survived with the same type of treatment. Because they are not ready for transplant. But that is a criteria given for transplant in international guidelines. Okay.
Suppose this patient becomes agitated in the emergency room. Okay. He has gone for a full-blown hepatic encephalopathy. Mm. How will you plan the sedation?
Sedation.
Which agent you will choose?
Short-acting agent, sir, will be usually preferred.
Which agent?
Usually midazolam is hepatic
degenerative.
Lorazepam will be
better. Dexmedetomidine will be the best agent for this patient. Maybe if you have some concern regarding hypotension, maybe you can avoid bolus dose and you can just start on infusion. So dexmed will be the preferred agent. That you have to, one thing that you need to remember. If this patient is having, because that is the one routine thing that will happen. They will be having acidosis. Mm-hmm. The lactate will start going up. Mm-hmm. They will be already having hepatic encephalopathy. So they will be agitated. So dexmed will be the preferred agent.
Mm-hmm.
Then what are the electrolytes that you need to be bothered? You said regarding some electrolytes. Mm-hmm. Specifically, why?
Because of the phosphate binding, there can be some electrolyte abnormalities. In yellow phosphorus poisoning, there can be hypocalcemia and hypokalemia, and zinc phosphate poisoning, hypomagnesemia is observed, sir, because of the binding.
And most important thing is hypoglycemia. So recurrent hypoglycemia, what does that indicate?
Because the gluconeogenesis is not happening, sir.
So that is
liver failure.
The patient is going for a liver failure. That is a bad prognostication. So hypoglycemia, lactate levels, acidosis. Definitely it is going to be, the mortality is going to be high for this group of patients.
How do you control seizures in this patient?
Benzodiazepines
are... benzodiazepine can be given, but only thing, like previously, it may produce prolonged sedation. So you can use it, but in emergency, otherwise try to avoid. What are the other better drugs?
Levetiracetam
is one of the best drug which can be used in liver failure. phenytoin, phosphenytoin, phenobarbital, all can be given, but all these things can aggravate the liver problem. If you are planning for a liver transplant, nothing is, all these things are immaterial. You are going to transplant this one. Okay. Otherwise, levetiracetam is a good drug.
Any role for antibiotics for this patient?
Yes, sir. Antibiotics, if at all the patient go for acute liver failure, antibiotics are usually given. Broad spectrum.
Usually means why we are giving antibiotics?
Prophylaxis.
For what?
Immunosuppression.
Liver failure.
And another thing is, he is having bleeding manifestations. Hmm. The chance of again infection is very high.
Okay, intra-abdominal infection, especially inside the gut. So you prefer a gram negative coverage, ceftriaxone, ceftriaxone,
antifungal
is also can be given. Okay. How is the patient now?
Patient is in the fifth day, sir. After okay. At present, patient's INR is not deteriorating.
Okay.
We have sent for a urine and blood samples for toxicologic analysis.
Okay.
And urine is showing contents, phosphorus content is there.
Okay.
So, we are monitoring her for the if at all if she worsens.
Okay. What are the reasons for not elevating INR in this type of toxins like pesticide or herbicide, whatever it is? What are the reasons for not elevating INR? You know that patient has taken.
If the tablet or the medicine is kept open for a prolonged
okay.
time,
so if it is exposed to environment, there is a high chance for reduction in the potency. Then expiry date. long term, it's kept for longer period, then patient has not taken
Laid.
That much. Whatever she has told us, it may not be correct. We cannot quantify it. In our lab, we are quantifying it or qualifying it.
Both are there, sir.
Quantification
and
qualification. Okay. So quantity is measured.
Qualitative measure only report has come, sir.
Okay.
In the urine only it is positive.
Okay. Anything
else? Yeah, suppose you are planning to discharge this patient.
Mm.
Okay. Once she is recovered, what are the basic things that you do for all deliberate self-harm?
This way, first a psychiatric evaluation should be kept, sir, because there can be a tendency to repeat that. Then parents should also be counseled regarding the same, sir. Then if at all there is some issues about police intimation should be given.
Should we intimate all poison?
Usually if the patient dies only, it becomes an MLC.
Not only that, all documentation should be like an MLC case only. But police case, it will become a police case if patient dies, or if you think that patient is deteriorating very fast, you want to take a dying declaration or something, then it is better to inform the police. So information to police doesn't mean that it's going to become a police case. So we can inform to make it a police case or not, that is depending on the police person, not doctor's decision. But better to inform the police so that if there is a foul play, it can be picked up by the police. Okay, thank you.